So today we're going to be looking from the book of Romans, chapter 2 specifically. So if you guys have your Bibles, how many of you guys brought your Bibles? Okay, were you guys good? If you don't have a Bible, please get a Bible from the back. Good job, son. I would encourage you guys really to please start bringing your own Bibles. I've been saying it week after week. And if you don't have a Bible, we have one that we can give to you. So if you need a Bible, just let us know, okay? So Romans, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, okay? New Testament, chapter 2. Found it? It's also up on the board, but... I'm using the NIV. I don't know what versions you guys have. Alright. So today we're going to be kind of looking at a really large chunk of passage. And so instead of reading the entire thing at once, I'm going to break it up into three different sections. And we'll be looking at it in three different sections. And so the first section that I want to look at was Romans chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. And so... I'll read, but if you guys could please follow along, either on the screen or on your Bibles. So, again, I'm using the NIV, so if your version is different, then the words will be a little different. You, therefore, have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else. For at whatever point you judge another, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the same things. Now we know that God's judgment against those who do such things is based on truth. So when you, a mere human being, passes judgment on them, and yet do the same things, do you think that you will escape God's judgment? Or do you show contempt for the riches of his kindness, forbearance, patience, not realizing God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance? So I'm going to look at the first four verses here. All right. And so I hope you guys follow along. And in my opinion, the NIV version is kind of hard to understand, at least the first verse. So what Paul is saying is, you know, when we judge others or condemn them, we're basically bringing upon that condemnation upon ourselves. Why? Because we do the same thing. And so does that mean if, let's say, there's a murderer in our midst? Hopefully not, but, you know, if, let's say, someone murders someone, we condemn them to death for murdering someone, does that mean because we condemn them or judge them that we should also receive death? No, that's not what Paul is saying. And actually, if we want to understand what Paul is getting at, we need to look at the context of chapter 2. And so we need to go to chapter 1. And so I'm not going to read all of chapter 1, but I'll summarize what Paul is saying. In chapter 1, Paul is describing how sinful humanity is, how sinful we are as human beings, right? That we've heard the truth, but instead of going to God, we're running away, right? We're exchanging the truth for a lot of evil things. And so as that happens, a lot of bad stuff starts happening. Paul lists a list of things that people start to do when we're not living for. And I'm not going to read all of them, but I'll give a few. So, greed, hate, envy, murder, quarreling, deception, bad behavior, gossip, being proud, and disobeying parents. Now, can any of you guys say that we've never sinned before? And I know we can't, right? And I know I can. But some of the ones that I've listed, you know, like murder, I haven't committed murder. But a lot of the other ones that I have done, and I still do, to this day, even though I try not to, you know, such as quarreling, you know, as human beings, we tend to get into arguments. And if you have siblings, you guys know what it's like to get into arguments pretty frequently, right? You know, your brother or sister does something small to annoy you, and then you're like, why'd you do that, right? You guys get very angry. I get very angry, too. Or, you know, being jealous of someone, or disobeying parents. And I'm pretty sure all of us here have at least disobeyed our parents one time in our life, right? We're not all perfect. And I know I've definitely disobeyed my parents, okay? When we realize that, you know, we're all sinners, that we all have made mistakes, we need to look at chapter 2, verse 1 in a different light. Paul is saying that we don't have the right to judge others because why? Because we're all sinners. We have all disobeyed God. We're all guilty of sin. You know, not a single one of us is without sin. And this verse shows, you know, how hypocritical that we are as human beings, right? We say one thing, but we do we do the exact opposite, or we, you know, say don't do this, but we do the same exact thing, right? And so we're very hopeless when it comes to saving ourselves. You know, for example, when I was in Seattle, I was working at a small local convenience shop, Timmy's uncle's place, actually. So on occasion, we would, you know, customers would come in, and on occasion, some of them were nice, but some were very, very rude, right? You know, I'd help them, and they'd be like, you know, they'd give me the cold shoulder and, like, say something kind of nasty to me, and then they'd just leave, and, okay, well, I don't know what I did wrong, but, and as they were leaving, I thought instantly in my head, man, I hope they get stuck in traffic, or I hope they, you know, they hit every single red light on the way home. You know, I think something like that. Maybe a little bit more extreme than that, but, you know, sometimes, you know, I don't want too much harm to come to them, but just enough annoyance, right? And, but the thing is, I'm being very hypocritical there because, you know, I know there's often cases where I'm very rude to people too, especially when I'm tired, when I'm stressed, it's easy to just not be patient with others, right? Just the smallest thing causes to, you know, explode and get very angry. On occasion, while, you know, we might be able to, you know, usually be patient with someone, you know, they say just one thing and that just hits us the wrong way, and we're like, you know, why'd you say that? And we blow up. And so, and I think we can all relate to this to a certain degree, right? You know, we say, you know, don't do this, but we do. And so again, we're all guilty of sin, no one is perfect, and we have all failed to live perfect and holy lives. And so when we say, you know, this person deserves punishment, in reality, we deserve punishment too, because, you know, we're all sinful. Ultimately, you know, wages of sin is death, right? And the only person we can see here in verse 2 and 3 is that only God has a right to give judgment, right? He has the right to decide, you know, who's right and who's wrong. Ultimately, why? Because he's holy and he's righteous. He's perfect, right? Unlike us as human beings. The second thing we need to notice is that it's God's character in verse 4. What does it say? You know, do you show contempt for the riches of his, so this is God's character, his kindness, his forbearance and patience, so endurance and patience, not realizing God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance. You know, so it's God is kind, he's patient, and, you know, his love endures, right? And so it's basically, to summarize it up, God is patient and he's merciful. He shows a lot of grace. And how true is this statement in our lives? And I know it's a statement that's true in my life every single day. You know, if I have to make a list of, you know, how many times I've sinned and made mistakes, and I have to write how many times God has forgiven me, you know, how many times God has forgiven me is always, you know, the same. It's never, oh, there's a couple sins that God has not been able to forgive, because he has been able to cover everything, right? It's nothing is not coverable by God, right? Nothing is too far for him to forgive. And I would say his grace and his list of forgiveness is longer than our current list of the things that we've done, because God knows, you know, we're going to mess up in the future. But, you know, as believers, we can have the assurance that even when we make mistakes in the future, God has already covered that. He already forgave us for that sin, right? He's already loved us to the point where, you know, with the one action of Christ on the cross and, you know, us believing, you know, he's already covered all of that. So his list of forgiveness extends way beyond our list of sins and the mistakes that we've done. He's shown us grace and mercy time and time again. And I know in my life, he's shown me grace and mercy time and time again. And when I just think about it, it really doesn't make sense that God would continue to forgive us, you know, over and over and over again. If, let's say you had a friend who kept on making the same mistake. This is a really silly example, but like 1 + 1, right? We know it's 2, but then he keeps on writing 3, right? You're like, no, 1 + 1 is 2. But then he keeps on, every single day he writes, 1 + 1 is 3, 1 + 1 is 3, 1 + 1 is 3. Eventually you'd be like, no, what are you doing? Like, how come you're not getting it, right? We'd get very upset. We'd be like, how come you're not getting this simple concept? But God is the same way, right? God just says, you know, obey me. And so we're like, okay, Lord, we'll obey you. And then we try, but we fail. We try again, and we fail. We try again, and we fail, right? The process repeats over and over and over and over again. But God still forgives us. And so, to me, that really doesn't make sense. But, you know, the amazing thing is that God is always willing to take us back. No matter how far we go, no matter how close we think we are, how far we've gone, God's love will cover all, right? If we turn back to him. And that's amazing, too. You know, and also, when it comes to judging others, if God has been able to show us this grace and mercy, shouldn't we be able to extend it to our fellow brothers and sisters just a little bit? You know, and we need to realize, as in verse 4, that God's kindness, his character, his goodness also has a purpose. The purpose of his kindness and patience and endurance isn't so that, you know, we can take advantage of it, right? You know, oh, I have this jail out of free card because God will forgive me. That's not the intention of God's character, of his goodness, his kindness, his patience, but it's to lead us to repentance. It's to lead us back to him. So God's mercy and grace should lead us back to repentance. When we realize how much God loves us, you know, that he sent his son, Jesus, right, down onto this earth. And just imagine, God who has everything, right, Jesus who has everything up in heaven comes down. It's like us coming down and saying, you know, son, would you be willing to, you know, come down, give up everything you have right now and become like a pig? No, right? No, you wouldn't want to become a pig, and especially a pig that's eventually going to be beaten, you know, abused, and then killed. No, right? But that's what Jesus did. Not saying he came down to a pig, but, you know, someone who's royal, you know, he has everything, comes down to our status, right? He comes down to our level, a human, right? A lowly human being, just vulnerable. He comes into the world into a very vulnerable state, you know, as a baby. And it's unthinkable that, you know, Jesus would do something like that, right? It's unthinkable. Because I know I would never do that, you know, give up my two opposable thumbs to become something with no opposable thumb. No way. And you know, he came down as a baby. He grew up to what? Well, why did he grow up? Basically to die for us, right? And he died not a heroic death, but he died a criminal death. You know, the cross was something meant for criminals, but you know, he wasn't a criminal, but yet he died along the side of two criminals, one on his right and one on his left. One of the most painful ways to die during that time. And so that's how much God loves us. And eventually, you know, he died, he rose again, and defeated death. And to this day, he loves us that much, right? His love is eternal. His love continues. How much he loved us back then, he still continues to love us today, right? He continues to show us his grace and mercy. And so, when I think on this truth daily, and this is something that I have to think about daily, even though, you know, I understand it, I understand his grace and mercy, it's something that I have to reflect on every day. And as I think and dwell on God's grace and God's mercy, I think of a simple saying, you know, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Right? So simple. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. It's so simple, but it's so true. And that's how much God loves us, right? And the Bible, the entire story of Jesus in the Bible tells us that he loves us, that God cares for us. And as I think about this truth, you know, God's grace, God's mercy, I'm in amazement. Thankfulness just naturally arises for what he has done. And so, you know, my heart was, as I was writing this sermon, I kind of wanted to relate it to Christmas, because Christmas is right around the corner. And Christmas, you know, we often forget what it's really about, right? It's not just another holiday. It's not like 4th of July where we have fireworks or Thanksgiving, right? But there is a major reason why we celebrate Christmas. And it's a major step in God's plan to redeem us, to save us, to repair the relationship that we once had, but that was broken. And now we see God's grace, God's mercy in action, right? Through his son. And now we have a decision to make. And if we look at verses 6 through 11, Paul gives us two very definitive ways that we're supposed to respond to the gospel, okay? And so, I'm here, since we're in church, I know we've all heard the gospel before, but I think it's still important to think about the gospel on a daily basis, and that's why I'm reiterating or re-saying multiple times, you know, how important the gospel is. And we also need to think about how we need to respond. So I'm going to look at verses 6 through 11, and I'll read it real quick. God will repay each person according to what he has done. To those who by persistence in doing good seek glory, honor, and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and reject the truth and follow evil, there will be wrath and anger. There will be troubles and distress for every human being who does evil, first for the Jew and then for the Gentile. But glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. For God does not show favoritism. Alright? So Paul is giving us two ways we can respond, right? The first way is in verse 7 and 10. And And what he's saying is that we can respond by giving glory to God, right? You know, repenting from our sinful nature, our sinful ways, you know, how we've been living before Christ, and as we can choose to, you know, put our faith in Christ, believe in Christ, follow after him, and give glory to God, right? And as a response, do the good works that he has called us to do. And eventually we can witness that glory in heaven. Be by Jesus in heaven with him on that, you know, final day, right? It's a beautiful sight. But the second option that we have is, it can either be active choice, or I would even argue that it can be inaction. Inaction tends to follow the second path, the second response that God, that Paul says that we have. And if we look at verse 8 and 9, there's nothing good that comes from this path, right? Wrath, anger, trouble, and distress, right? That doesn't sound very good. And that's what happens when, you know, we decide not to follow after God. We don't pursue his goodness, his righteousness, his love and mercy, right? We start to live more selfishly, and we don't really do good works, right? And although we may, you know, there's plenty of people in the world, you know, who don't don't believe in Christ, and they might have good lives temporarily, but in the end, it won't matter, because when we die, it doesn't matter, you know, how rich we are, how poor we are, you know, if we die old, if we die young, it doesn't matter, because our status won't matter, you know, what we achieve in life, right? And it's all about, you know, where are we investing our time? Where are we investing our energy? Who are we following after? And again, you know, one of our biggest dangers is thinking, especially I know my age group, and I'm sure your guys, you know, we have a lot of inaction. We have a lot of apathy. You know, I know when I go out to eat sometimes, our friends are like, oh, where do you want to eat? I don't know. Where do you want to eat? I don't know. How about this? Like, no, I don't really feel like hamburger right now. Oh, how about this? No, I don't really want to follow either. You know, it just goes on forever, right? We're very indecisive when it comes. But we have to choose, you know, very actively. We have to partake in choosing which way do we want to respond to the gospel, right? How do we want to respond to Christ dying for us? And so we need to choose. Am I going to go all in? And I know this year's theme was going all in for Christ, right? You know, are we going to go all in for Christ, or are we not? Because there's no half-heartedness. We can't serve two masters, right? We can't say, Lord, I'm going to go 90% in for you and then give this 10% for me. It's because we're serving two masters, right? We can't even say 99%, 99.9999%, but this 0.00001% or whatever it is, you know, I'm not following you. We need to go all in, right? And once we do commit to following Christ, you know, it's the start of a journey, and it's a wonderful journey. You know, as believers, again, that's just the first step, right? Accepting God, you know, following, putting our faith in Christ. But on a daily basis, we need to choose Christ daily. And as a believer, I know there's some days where it's very difficult to follow after Christ, right? But in Luke 9:23, it says, Jesus says, you know, take up the cross daily and follow me. And the cross sounds like a burden, right? You know, it's something that we have to carry, but it shouldn't be a burden because, you know, it's to crucify our sinful flesh, right? Our nature, right? And that might be difficult at first, but the more we fall after Christ, the more we choose him daily, the easier and easier it should get. And you know, as we carry the cross, God is leading us. Christ is leading us, right? We're not doing this by ourselves, but we're doing it with the power of the Holy Spirit and Jesus, you know, just guiding us. And you know, this is something that I have to do every day, right? Just think about God's forgiveness and just thinking about, you know, who am I going to live for? Because if I don't actively think I'm living for Christ, then I'm just, honestly, I'm just living for myself. And I have to put myself in the right mindset every single morning. And I would really encourage you guys to do the same thing, right? Every single morning, just think, you know, who am I living for? And be honest with yourself. If you can't be honest with yourself, we're never going to be able to grow, right? We have to be honest, you know. Am I living selfishly or am I living for God? And as I meditate on what Christ has done for me and just looking back on my life and how God has shaped me, the only response that I have is, yes, Lord, right? Yes, Lord, lead me. That's my response. So let's look at the last couple of verses. I'm going to read verse 12. All who sin apart from the law will also perish apart from the law, and all who sin under the law will be judged by the law. And so what Paul is saying is here is, you know, whether we follow the law or not, we're going to be judged for our sins, right? And so what Paul is saying is, he's not saying that we can be successful in terms of living by ourselves and trying to be perfect by ourselves. Because no matter what, we want to at least make one mistake along the way. And so, so if we look at the Israelites, right? God gave them the tabernacle. He gave them the laws to follow. But even with the laws, they have to do a lot of sin offering, right? Because they kept on messing up. Even though they're God's chosen people, even though they had the law, they kept on messing up, right? And so the priest would have to, you know, give a sin offering. And on the Day of Atonement, they would, you know, put all the sins of the entire nation on a lamb, right? The blood of the lamb would be the thing that saves them. And ultimately, it is the blood of the lamb, right, that saves us too, which is Jesus. You know, that's, you know, right back then, they had to sacrifice a lot of animals. But for us, in this time, in 2015, since Jesus died on the cross for us, he shed his blood for us, roughly 2015 years ago, right? And so let's look at the next verse, 13. For it is not those who hear the law who are righteous in God's sight, but those who obey the law who will be declared righteous. And so, you know, what this verse is saying is, it's pretty simple. It's not enough to hear the word of God. And I know growing up in church, we hear the word of God a lot, right? But it can't just come in through one ear and out the other, right? Right. It's not enough to just listen and hear the word of God, but it is for us to obey it. And that's what is the next step, right? Obeying God's word, what God commands us to do, what he wants us to do. Right? And it should come from a heart change, ultimately. It shouldn't just be, I'm going to will myself to be a better person. I'm going to will myself to be a better Christian because, you know, because ultimately it has to come from the heart, right? And God changes our hearts, right? And as we accept Christ, God, the Holy Spirit is going to be working in our hearts to shape us, to mold us into a better follower of him. So we desire him more. We want to be like Christ more as we mature. And I want to skip down to the last verse here. It says, this will take place on that day when God judges people's secrets through Jesus Christ, as my gospel declares. And so, you know, there's a day where, you know, we'll all fade away from this life into the next. But, you know, as believers, we don't have to be scared of that, right? Because we have that confidence of who we are in Christ. That on that day, when we see God, you know, we're not scared. We're not standing there before God with our sinfulness. But, you know, Jesus is standing in our place, right? Because he took our sins on him, right? And so it's not our sinfulness in front of God, but it's Jesus' righteousness that vouches for us, right? That vouches for us, you know. Even though we've not lived the perfect life, it's Jesus' blood. It's not about what we've done, but it's all about what Jesus has done. He's done everything. He came down to earth. He lived a perfect life. He died. He took our beatings. He rose again, right? There's nothing in there where it says, oh, we forced Jesus. Or there's nothing to say, there's no asterisk in the bottom of the Bible that says, but, you know, we helped, you know, the entire process, right? All we did was kind of mess up the process. But God's still working. And, you know, again, as I was studying this passage, originally I was heading towards a different direction, but the more and more I read this passage, the more I saw God in it. The more I saw, you know, how much more we need Jesus, how much more we need his love, his grace, and mercy. And it's honestly just amazing that, you know, God knew how sinful we are as people. You know, how many times do we mess up? Over and over again, right? Even though he knew that we would rebel constantly, even though he knew we wouldn't follow, he still sent his son, right? He still sent his son, and Jesus willingly died, right? And that's just the amazing fact that my brain physically cannot comprehend that he would do that for us, right? You know, his enemies, as sinners. And this is the beauty of Christmas, right? This is what Christmas is all about. It's not about the gifts. It's not about winter break. It's not about family and friends. While those are good things to, you know, do, celebrate with, right? Those are all amazing things. But Christmas is really, again, about the Savior of the world coming in the form of a baby, right? And we really need to meditate and think about that as we go into this next couple of weeks. That it's not just a fun time. And I want you guys to have fun. I want you guys to, you know, really have fun with your friends, eat a lot of Christmas cookies, drink hot chocolate or whatnot. But I want you guys to really think about and meditate. You know, what does Christmas mean? What does it mean for me personally? So this week, I would really encourage you guys to meditate. What is the meaning of Christmas, and what does it mean for you? Is it just another holiday where we can just relax and have fun? Or are we really thinking about what has been done for us? Because as believers, you know, Christmas is more than that. So think of just how much Jesus loves you, that he came down, right, from this high place to this lowly place. And just think about how much he has saved you from. And in the truth of that, let's really respond to God's love. Whether we have not put our faith in him yet, you know, let's do that. But as believers, if we have, let's continue to follow him daily, right? Day after day after day. And so, yeah, let's pray.